down here in the red, at the bottom right, from the Team OGS.
OGS time.
He's looking mighty fine in this series so far. Now to our blue Terran, who's lost the two previous games but seems to have good late games.
Tenex.
There he is. We have so many artistic people that follow this game.
Wow.
That's actually really good.
That's really good.
That's really good.
That person should be locked in a basement drawing anime all day.
No kidding.
Yeah.
That's some talented artwork. Of course, artistic people are smart people. Smart people are
watch
also StarCraft people. Yeah, watch the GSL.
If you're smart, you watch this. Hence, you're watching it now.
Yeah.
Not many people think they're dumb, so there we go.
There you go.
That's one self-fulfilling prophecy.
So, will Zenix be on once again to a fast expand? I'm curious because this is a map where OGS top strategy in game two could work very well.
Yeah.
In fact, I almost think you shouldn't fast expand in TBT on this map.
Yeah, there's a lot of ways you can be attacked. The map architecture is very, very odd. By the way, we do see that Byung going to scout top very quickly. And we have to point out that this is a rotationally symmetric map.
Symmetrical map.
Well, when I say rotationally, I don't think I put symmetrical. Do I? Rotationally symmetric or
symmetrical? Yeah, rotationally symmetrical.
Okay. Words are hard. Anyways, basically there's a slight advantage for top being the position he's in because...
Wait a minute, now I'm scared. I think I might have said it wrong. One of us is wrong. This
one
is
of us
terrible.
Is wrong. That's fine. One of us is right.
That's right.
And that's all
and
Archon needs,
And if we're casting
man.
Archon, yeah. then I guess that makes
that,
us...
That makes us both right.
Yeah. All right.
Anyways, after logicing our way out of
yeah.
that one...
After rationalizing that...
OGS top's starting position is going to be just slightly better than Zenix Beyond's because they do have expansions that are guarded by their main base behind them.
But those are accessible to siege tanks.
Yes, they are accessible to siege tanks, but right now Beyond's is easy to drop for a top compared to top's, which is hard to drop for Beyond's.
Yeah,
so it's a little bit closer.
Point.
So that's going to give top just the slightest advantage. It may not even come into play this game. It has before. It doesn't always. That's something obviously you have to take into consideration as soon as you scout your opponent on this map.
SCP peaks.
None shall pass. So he brings his friends.
Once
oh,
again,
passing.
You know, Zenix Beyond loves to do this. He loves to be aggressive with a small number of units early on. I think it's smart.
Yeah.
Because if your opponent's doing anything that's cutting corners, you're going to kill him off.
Very true. You know, just poking and prodding with the units he would have anyways.
Looks like OGS top's going to go for a Banshee build.
Looks like both are going to go for Banshee
probably,
builds.
Probably the best build to do on this map.
Yeah, I do like Banshee on this map.
I mean, that it's also a good a build on Scrap Station, but frankly, there's not, I think, much else you can do. If you think your opponent's doing that build, you should get a Viking first, then a Banshee. There are some people that would disagree and say you should get the Viking second, Banshee first, and the Banshee has more energy.
Mm.
But I like to send my first Viking out and try to intercept his Banshee, especially in positions like this where it's pretty clear where the angle of the Banshee is going to be coming from. You go in there, intercept it, take it out before Cloak is finished, and basically get ahead. But they're both going to go for Banshee first. Let's see if they even get a Viking at all.
Yeah, pretty interesting there. Cloak, both are going for Cloak. So, we are going to have to see, Tasteless, how many SCVs they can kill for each other. Of course, it's going to be very annoying for both of them to try to deal with Banshees. If they don't have any Vikings, it's just going to be Marines without Stim,
yeah.
which don't do a great job. And we do see a Cloak used.
Simultaneous scans there.
Yeah.
Literally
I see a cloak
perfectly
used,
mirrored builds.
Yeah, they both are going to see basically what's going on.
Their response is to get a Raven next.
Interestingly enough, when Beyond scanned, he actually didn't see the tech lab, so he can't be 100% sure. But now it looks like a Raven is being created for OGS top, while a second Banshee and a missile turret being created for Beyond. So he's going to go ahead and counter that with a missile turret as opposed to a Raven. Here comes top.
That missile turret's pretty well positioned.
Yeah, that's a very
I was actually going to criticize, and then I thought, well, actually, that covers the SCVs pretty well.
Yeah, it's going to be hard to even fly behind that. It's quite a ways. Now, Bjorn coming in with his cloaked Banshee. The Raven just popping out now. He's going to see that Raven and want to get out of there. Raven's a little bit slower.
So, nice job here. At least takes out the depot. Something better than nothing. That does a temporarily supply block Zenex Bjorn.
Now, how are they going to transition out of this? I really like that both players are going to end up with a Raven. Bjorn making his Raven now a little bit later. And we do have some more Banshee harassment. Trying to take out a Tech Lab here. Of course, if you send an SCV down to repair that, he's going to kill the SCV as well. And making him use a scan. Will that Banshee go down?
No, it actually manages to live.
With just 34 hit points left. It's a very damaged Banshee. Good thing that they don't have return policies on Banshees like they do on bunkers.
No kidding.
Imagine that.
Whoever's selling those bunkers is a fool.
I know.
He's going to be out of business pretty soon.
Well, it's all about serving his customers' tastes, and sometimes that is your best business plan.
That's true. Looks like Terran, OGS top, excuse me, not... Terran is a bit too ambiguous.
he's like, Terran is building SCVs.
Terran is winning. No, wait, Terran might lose. He's going to move out a little bit here. Now, I don't feel like a push from either of these guys would be a good idea. I'm kind of curious about when you have Marines and siege tanks, and it doesn't seem like it's entered the Viking phase, or it will. What role does a Raven really play?
Yeah.
What's the best way to use a Raven? Because there's only one Viking out, I believe, on the map.
Yeah, there's not a whole lot of Vikings out there for sure. It looks like, you're right, just one Viking out for Bjorn. Nice little harassment here.
Oh my god, that's actually huge. Oh no! Oh, he barely saves it. That would have actually changed everything.
That was very nice by Top to try that.
I suppose if your opponent doesn't have Vikings out and you know he's expanding, one thing you could do is go to the back of your opponent's base and put an auto turret up there, and then push his front and contain.
You love little strategies like that, Tasteless.
I do.
You love diverting attention and going down your Tasteless secret hallways to
That's
punish
right.
people for paying attention to that.
That's my playstyle, man.
I know it.
We played many a game. Now, the command center's on the way. Looks like the orbital, excuse me. Looks like Zenex Bjorn once again the first one to initiate map control. OGS top, a little bit more of a passive player now if he is in a macro game.
He has been making some Vikings, so looks like he's going to have they have the same amount of Vikings right now. Very similar SCV counts. For the first time, Bjorn has more SCVs at 40 to 36. And we're going to see a lot of positional battles from here, Tasteless.
You got to be pretty careful.
Oh, no,
nice.
Bjorn!
Point defense drone there. Nice save. Back to what I was saying, I think this is a situation where you got to be very careful with your Vikings and Ravens. They're not fast units at all. They're slow as ever. These unit stalkers
slow as ever.
As ever, man. They can actually walk and catch up. So stalkers can actually walk and catch up to a Viking.
Yeah, they very much can. And they oftentimes do.
Yeah. Especially to my Vikings, which is sad.
Sorry. I didn't know it was such a personal issue for you.
I don't want to talk about it.
All right. Well, you know, Zenex Bjorn has a pretty good defensive position. Top going to keep on moving around, repositioning his tanks, and that's a great thing to do. You want to keep repositioning, see if you can't pick off a little bit here, there, everywhere. If your opponent isn't attacking you, you don't have to sit there defensively. You can walk around, threaten him, try to catch him off guard, and eventually you may do that, and that can turn a game around completely.
Little scan over here. I'm curious as to who's going to take the third base, which will probably be a gold base. Because unlike in a Terran vs. Terran where it's just blue bases, getting the third base means you're going to be vulnerable for a few minutes, you know, until you can have your economic explosion. But taking a gold, you get that economic explosion so fast.
Yeah.
Things can get out of hand.
Yeah, you don't have to make as many SCVs. Your mule's obviously amazing. And, this isn't. Oh, okay. He's just transferring us to use him. Well, we see Bjorn looking like he wants to do some damage, Tasteless.
Whoa! Missed control there by Top. He's going to lose the air dominance here. He's going to lose the Raven as well.
Yeah, that is pretty big deal there. Oh. Beyond doing a good job. Even using his point defense drone wisely. And he's going to take out every Viking Tasteless.
Oh, this is bad news.
Beyond is a Viking battle champion.
He is definitely good at controlling the air. Once again, Top unable to deal with Beyond's map dominance here.
But Top kind of counterattack, it looks like.
Oh, very nice.
Not a lot of units out here for Beyond.
Stimming here. Sieging up.
Siegechanks in position. Beyond coming up from the low ground. But Top still with some Marines left over. Marines being rallied out by Beyond. Gonna land his Vikings now, and that is dangerous.
He had the air dominance here, but he's going to lose some Vikings. They're going to be softened up. Even though ZX Beyond held off that attack, the Vikings are going to be weakened up. You can see instantly he's going to repair them. He knows that if he gets down on the Viking count, it's going to change the landscape of this game. Looks like Top isn't done yet, though. He knows the tank count is low. He wants those Vikings to land again.
And good thing those SCVs were still there, holding the Marines back from killing the siege tank.
That was actually insane. Top should have won that battle, but those... the presence of those SCVs made it so that the Marines weren't enraged in the siege tanks.
That actually could have been a game-finishing attack.
It.
But the SCVs, man, they just slowed those Marines down, let that siege tank do its damage.
Talk about taking one for the team.
I know it. Oh, my God. This is now it's so even again. 105 supply to 106. Beyond up by one. Pretty crazy. He's winning the Viking battle. Same number of sea shanks, less Marines.
Looks like he's going to do it again. I think this is a blunder here from Top. I don't know if he should be doing this.
This one may not work out as well.
Okay, that was just...
snipes a sea shank, but it costs him a lot. Even loses a medevac.
I believe I might have just misspoke and said that might have been a blunder there for Beyond. I was talking about Top. Since Top is the one actually making a strategic move right now.
Beyond can't blunder by just sitting there with sea shanks. That's actually an unblunderable position in an attack on you.
Well, Young's defense has been pretty solid.
Yeah, and his Viking battles, man, he always wins it. He is a masterful Viking pilot. In the air, on the ground, flying around at the speed of sound. Beyond.
Uh-oh, stimmed Marines. Gonna try to catch up, but Beyond adroitly pulls back.
Just as I talk about his Vikings, he flies one into a Marine.
Okay, stimming once again.
Whoa, the Marines all clumped up. A bloody battle indeed. Beyond with a good amount of medevacs, though.
Oh, my God.
And he cleans that up. Right now, Beyond in the lead. 130 supply to 113.
Can you check the upgrades on those Marines?
I would love to, Tasteless.
I did not actually expect that.
Just plus one attack.
Huh.
Meantime, Top, no upgrades. But Top coming in from behind while Beyond is attacking some destructible debris. Can Top get into a good position here?
Actually, I don't think he can. I think he has two little units.
Yeah, it's beginning to look like that, Tasteless. Sea Chinks up Beyond. Owning up.
Wow. Well, Top has made too many mistakes in a row. And you can see what's great about Beyond's play is he's not just counterattacking. He says, wait a minute. Gonna kill the rocks, then attack. Actually, it looks like Top's gonna do the same thing. But he better be ready because now it's Beyond's turn to start to turn up the heat here.
Well, Top is going to have to set up Tasis because here comes Beyond. And, well, Top bringing out a ton of SCVs. He is not playing around. He wants to kill off this attack. And it looks like he will.
He holds it, but look, if you look at the SCV count, it's 57 to 85.
Beyond in the lead there. But right now, Beyond with no siege tanks, so Top has this rush timing that very well may mean the end for Beyond.
Yeah, small window of time here for Top to seize the moment. If Beyond survives this, Beyond's going to be in the lead for the late game.
That's right.
Even though it's two base versus two base, we're actually in the late game. Long distance mining here. Uh-oh. Top destroying all these SCVs.
Very nice move by Top. This is exactly the type of thing he needs to do to start clawing his way back in.
He needs to get a siege tank in range of the orbital.
This is actually a lot of siege tanks. Moving forward, sieging up. And Beyond's going to have to bring down his SCVs now, Tasteless. Looks like Top is taking a severe lead here with this attack.
actually top might just win this. He was behind SCVs, but I think I spoke too soon because now all these SCVs are going to be picked off. So many blue SCVs destroyed here.
But he is taking out C-Chanks, and that's pretty important at this moment. And he will go down in SCVs overall.
You rarely see a Terran versus Terran that turns into a slugfest like this.
Yeah, and this one isn't even one of those, you know, funny games that we saw in the beginning of Code A, you know, the round of 32,
yeah,
where we're
different.
Like, wow, everything's bad. No, this is actually very solid play where they are abusing each other for losing any units that were lost in smart
these
ways.
These guys are not two snurfs.
No, they are not.
That's for sure.
These guys are true Thundercats.
They are.
Thundercats.
I love that show.
It's actually terrible. Have you seen it in the last few years?
No, I don't want to see it. It's going to ruin it for me.
Yeah, it will. Well, Top is going to take an extra base before Bjorn is going to get it.
I like Bjorn's tight play style. He actually lifted it off his own orbital in the main to take the gold. He says, I'm not even going to spend an extra 400 minerals on an expansion. No. I'm going to spend that on attacking units. I'm going to mine up my main and just relocate.
A good choice indeed.
I really like that.
Yeah. In fact, he has a lot of gas already anyway, so he doesn't need that main gas.
Now he's got the gold.
Yeah, both players taking gold bases. Mules plus SCVs being transferred to them.
We could see a fourth base for both of these guys pretty sooner with the additional income from the gold.
Right now, pretty close game. 104 supply for Top, 100 for Bjorn.
I'm pretty sure both these guys aren't sure who's winning and who's losing.
Yeah,
it's been a very complex game. Very, very complicated.
If I had to
say, so many factors and variables. I'm not even entirely sure who's ahead right now.
If I had to say, I would say Top just slightly. Like, so slightly that it doesn't even matter. Absolutely not in any way that he can force into a win.
Terran versus Terran, sometimes a matchup of stamina.
Oh, and Bjorn may be making a big mistake here. Taking a lot of damage on his Sea Chanks. He's got to be very careful about that. In the meantime, Top is moving around the map with a drop. Look at this. Two dropships full of Marines.
Drop from Top.
And this might be the top drop of the game, Tasteless.
We're going to find out.
Here we go. Bjorn has units semi-nearby. Moves his SCVs immediately. Very quick.
He wants to get those medevacs instantly. Nice. Gets one.
Snaps both medevac necks.
Taken out.
Yeah, and now Top is going to be in some trouble.
He might as well have put those medevacs in a gift basket with fruits and soaps and stuff.
Wow. Tasteless, we talk about Top's macro a lot, but even after losing two medevacs full of Marines, that's 20 supply total, doing no damage. The supply right now, 133 against 133. I don't know how he does it.
I actually have no clue either, because normally we see somebody lose a big army and we're like, okay, we know who's ahead. But then we check the supply with Top and it's like, well, Top still has more units.
Yeah.
I don't know how that's possible.
It is crazy.
I would love to learn exactly what his hotkey setup is, what his macro rotation is.
His hotkey setup is 2 for army, 3 for one of his orbitals.
7 for
4 has
four for
all of his production
factories.
Facilities. And 5 has 2 other orbitals.
Interesting. Here comes a battle. OGS Top actually taking huge blows here, but does back up.
Perfect backup time by Bjorn. Kills the maximum amount before diminishing returns set in with all his Marines being so damaged. Very good attacks by Bjorn, and he goes up in supply, 150 to 133. Both players producing almost only Marines and Siege Tanks.
Oh, nice. Small window of time where the Siege Tanks are on Siege. Marines doing damage. Dart out. Only taking about one Siege Tank shot. The medevacs are slow. Marines are going to have to back up and try to defend. Those medevacs going for the tanks now.
Oh,
nice split.
Nice splitting. Taking out some additional Siege Tanks. That is huge. And Bjorn breaking through this Siege line.
Oh, my God. I think if you got about 5 tanks back there, that's going to really reset the position battle here for Top.
That was Bjorn. Pretty wild, Tasteless. Bjorn takes the tank lead with 11 to 8.
Now, Bjorn, you can see he's debating even pushing in here.
I think his counter push could be strong, but it looks like he's going to send some tanks to the high ground.
Oh, very nice.
Should siege up the rest of those tanks as well.
Focus fire the center of that tank group.
That was a beautiful scan by Top, sniping out some of the siege tanks, and Bjorn a little bit out of position, but dropping some Marines on these siege tanks might force an unsiege.
Marine bombs here.
And he is taking out so many tanks.
That is a hero,
oh, wow.
Marine.
Bjorn takes the tank lead once again. Siege tank barely getting out with its life.
It's all about this high ground location. He wants to put all of these siege tanks right over there. Look, or down here. Okay. Looks like Top is going to try to counterattack.
Indeed he is.
Uh-oh.
It's a powerful army, Tasteless. But he turns around.
He intercepts, blocks. Bjorn is very good at controlling the game, containing his opponent.
Yeah, Bjorn keeps on doing these very nice small pushes. In fact, he's going to stim in some Marines and then decide to turn around. Smartly so, it's Top's army coming
Bjorn
right
in. Bjorn has a slight edge here, but he's got to be careful not to give it up. Oh, nice.
Drawing him into the siege tank lines. Top making a blunder here.
That could be it, GG.
GG.
That's all it took.
Really nice attacks. That was actually
go.
Amazingly awesome TBT. One of the more exciting ones. I love the
tactics.
That
was one of the best TBTs I've seen.
There were very few mistakes. They both made a lot of really good, aggressive, positional-based moves. I like that game.
I love that game. Well, you know, when you destroy your opponent's stuff, you always have this small chance to attack into them, try to siege up when they're lower on tanks.
Yeah.
So different from the rest of the Code A matches.
Yeah.
Which were just snurp-tastic.
These two definitely a level ahead of the other Terrans
yeah.
in Code A. No question about that. Now it's tied up 2-2. This is actually becoming a very exciting
yeah.
Code A finals.
Pretty awesome. So we've done, what, 4 games now?
Yes.
So we're going to cut to a little bit of a break. I don't know if we can get a game better than that.
No,
especially
that was,
for Delta Quadrant.
I actually
learned so much.
I enjoyed that game immensely.
Zenix, you know, one moment that I just loved was when he didn't make a third command center. He actually waited. So I'm going to mine out. This has become a slugfest. Every mineral counts. And he just lifted from his main to the gold.
That can be a beautiful move. Sometimes people do not do that when they absolutely should.
That's one of the rare situations where you want to do that. Normally you never do that, but because of that map and the way it's set up, that was the right thing to do.
Yeah, no, it was, as you all saw, I mean, battles hinged on his fewest 4 Marines.
Yeah.
So we're going
to take
a
5-minute break. What should they do on their break, Artosis?
Tasteless, they should think about how awesome that game was.
Yeah. Might want to go write in your journal.
Yeah.
Dear Diary, Terran vs. Terran is so awesome. Only you understand, your diary. The end of the world. The sky's falling.